Yet once we did this experiment and saw for the first time that the spherical nucleic acids not only enter but are actively transported, we knew we had something quite special.
Welcome to Nano Matters, the podcast that explores specific examples of nanotechnology. I'm Lisa Friedersdorf, Director of the National Nanotechnology Coordination Office, and here with me today is Chad Mirkin, Director of the International Institute for Nanotechnology at Northwestern University. So, Chad, what is a cancer immunotherapy or vaccine?
So, an immunotherapy is a type of therapy that trains one's immune system to fight a specific disease. So, a vaccine is a class of immunotherapies. A vaccine is a material that basically trains your immune system to specifically eradicate a foreign entity, a virus, a bacteria. In the case of cancer, it would be a type of material that would train your immune system to specifically eradicate cancer cells, shrink tumors, and hopefully cure the disease.
So I guess I've never thought of a vaccine as training my immune system. Taking my children, or if I even remember back to my own vaccines and shots I got as a child, is that what you do with a cancer immunotherapy? Is it something like a shot?
It's very similar. It absolutely is a shot. So in our case, we develop drugs based upon what we call spherical nucleic acid. These are globular forms of DNA and RNA. And it's known through studies of viral and bacterial disease that certain sequences can stimulate your immune system in a selective way. And so we formulate these spherical nucleic acids with sequences that are designed to activate your immune system by engaging with structures called toll-like receptors, toll-like receptor 9 in particular. That elevates your immune system. And when you combine those types of structures with a peptide, a fragment of a protein that is a specific signature of the cancer cell, associated with the cancer cell, the vaccine trains your T cells to go throughout the lymphatic system, find cells that have that signature, and to lyse them.
So what are the challenges to developing these immunotherapies, and how does nanotechnology play a role?
Well, nanotechnology is going to play a huge role. I'm convinced of it. In vaccine development in general, in cancer immunotherapy in particular, we like to refer to it as rational vaccinology. And what I mean by that is, what we've discovered through our research is that just taking the components that are required to create an immunotherapy and injecting them in a black box type of approach is not good enough. You sometimes can find materials that act as vaccines in that way. And in fact, we've done that predominantly in the past. But with nanotechnology, we're finding that how you structure the different components, how you present them to the immune system, can have dramatic effects on how potent they are. And we have different types of vaccines that in one format are completely ineffective, while in another format are totally curative.
So how did you become inspired to work on these globs of DNA, RNA, these spherical nucleic acids?
Well, we invented them. over 20 years ago, we were just playing with nanoparticles and DNA. Not trying to create medicines, not trying to create diagnostic tools, but trying to create what we call programmable atoms. And we developed the chemistry for interfacing short snippets of DNA and RNA with spherical nanoparticles. And we developed the chemistry for loading those short strands of DNA and RNA on the surface of the particle. And in high loadings, they are forced to stand upright, and they take on the shape of that central particle core, hence the term spherical nucleic acid. Those particles actually do act as synthetic atoms. You can kind of think of them as chemically specific Velcro balls. And we learned how to take different types of spherical nucleic acids, and by combining them with partners that they could hybridize with, form the famous double helix, they would bond together, and we could build colloidal crystals from the bottom up. There's a whole field that focuses on that that's become very interesting in its own right. But along the way, we discovered that these globular forms of DNA and RNA had completely different properties from the normal linear forms of DNA and RNA. So on a sequence-for-sequence basis, they are completely different. And I'll give you an example. Normal DNA and RNA will not enter human cells. Whereas spherical nucleic acids not only enter, but are actively taken across the cell membrane. It took us 10 years to run that experiment because we were thinking about these new forms of DNA and RNA as the old forms. And we knew that DNA, linear DNA and RNA wouldn't enter cells. Yet once we did this experiment and saw for the first time that the spherical nucleic acids not only enter, but are actively transported, we knew we had something quite special. And that meant that for the first time, we could get large amounts of DNA and RNA into cells. And we could think about using that capabilities to make measurements with respect to what's inside cells, but also to manipulate how cells function. And that led us down the path of developing gene regulation tools. That led to a whole series of drugs where we could regulate gene expression, but it also led to the development of immunotherapies where we could use globular forms with the right sequences that were designed to tickle the immune system in a way that would make it useful for vaccine development.
Can you share what types of diseases could be impacted by this approach?
Oh, it's very exciting. Look, six human clinical trials have already commenced, either over or are currently ongoing, based upon spherical nucleic acids. They are for diseases like glioblastoma, deadly form of brain cancer. There are immunotherapies now for treating a wide range of cancers, including deadly forms of skin cancer. There are gene regulation therapeutics that are designed to knock down inflammatory markers that are associated with psoriasis and atopic dermatitis. There is a drug that is designed to reverse the symptoms of young children that suffer from a disease called SMA, spinal muscular atrophy, a very debilitating disease and one that really adversely affects young children in very significant ways. And then there are a whole series of other drugs that are being developed and tested for a broad range of indications, ranging from diabetic wound healing to, you know, more innocuous things like coming up with the cure for baldness.
Also very important. Well, I've very much enjoyed talking with you today. Do you have any closing thoughts that you want to share?
I think we have to be patient with these types of things. I think everybody wants a quick fix. They either want to decide something's no good or something's great overnight. In medicine, especially in the area of nanomedicine, where we're just learning the rules of the road, we're going to have to be patient. But I think if we're patient, really good things are going to come out of it. And I'm quite confident that we are going to not only impact the field of medicine, but I think change how medicine is practiced, and certainly how disease is studied, and also how it's both diagnosed and treated. And I think that's exciting.